Thanks so much. Well, thanks everybody for showing up today. Again, Billy Jurewicz with Space 150. I'm the CEO. And Space 150 is a digital agency, so we're a digital advertising agency in the sense we're not necessarily an event company, but we do things for Target, for 3M, American Express, B-Dubs, and then Forever 21, which we'll talk about today. And then mostly this whole idea of this kind of shape-shifting of digital to a physical property. And this kind of convergence that we're seeing a lot of these things from traditional advertising to kind of product development. So with that being said, we'll fast forward here. Who am I? So why am I even up here and why can I talk to you about these types of things? A little bit about my background is I grew up in the 70s, so a little bit of the Fonz, the cool guy, right? And then a little bit of the geek. So Bill Gates and those guys in the 70s kind of look like this. They're not like Jack Dorsey, these suave guys, but they're a little bit cool, 51% cool guys, 49% the geeks. So it's a little bit of a blend because they can still get the chicks, you know, like the Fonz at the 51%. But this is going to come back later in the presentation about why you need to almost blend the freak and the geek to get these kind of cool products happening from that sense. I grew up with Pong, ColecoVision, Commodore 64, VIC-20. Anyone know these things? Mario Brothers all the way to Grand Theft Auto 5. Anyone play that? That's great. So a lot of technology that's been happening from that kind of shift throughout kind of our lifespan is, you know, kind of an influence to it. Started with the Sterling Cooper-like agencies, so back with the Don Draper types, where they have no concept of technology, no concept of what digital really means, and even to some degree today, that's still really happening. They just do television spots and kind of move that forward. So I started an agency. I came from Fallon, that was in Minneapolis in 2000, based on this kind of digital frontier that's going to be happening. And today, here we are 13 years later, doing a lot of different things with installments and that type of thing. So what is this digital and physical? What does this really kind of necessarily mean? So if you take a look at that, fuel band's probably the most obvious because it's, you know, a technology that can track your calories, your fuel points, and you wear it. Onto the Nest, where you start seeing this infiltrate in your homes, thermostats, things like that for the Nest, all the way to that diet fork. I don't know if everyone's seen that diet fork at CES last year. I don't know if it works. Who's got a diet fork, anybody? Exactly. So you see a lot of stuff happens that kind of hits the floor, but at least they're trying to get this kind of thing there. The true embodiment to me then is Tesla. So that actually is a gigantic computer. There's no gas, there's no oil, there's no fluids. It's a gigantic computer that is a physical digital product actually on the streets. Bad battery problems, but I think they're working on that right now. Take that to product. So if you look at that next level from Uber, which we all use all the time, even a lot of the 3D mapping for iPhones, we can see your house, and even doing a lot of stuff for real estate. Starbucks, early adopters and rewards programs for these kind of physical to digital products, and obviously the airlines really picked that up. And Nike's a big kind of frontier forefront with even the women's app for Nike is actually pretty good. For us, let's get into it. Forever 21, so if everyone knows this, I don't know if there's a big Forever 21 crowd here. It's cheap, chic clothing. So $5 t-shirts, you know, $3 socks, jewelry for 20 cents. It's really this kind of trashy, kind of fun kind of stuff. And they took over the Virgin Megastore in Times Square. So if you take a look at that iconic billboard in New York, which had this Richard Branson kind of, you know, fluorescent light bulb equalizer thing going on at the time, was that was like the bee's knees of Times Square. This was the most ultimate coolest thing. Forever 21's taken over the record store, and we have to do something that's going to be as cool as that. Right across the street was this thing called American Eagle, which was a 14-story digital board, about $20 million, and we had a fraction of that budget to try to compete with our competitors with this gigantic, you know, humongous, overspent kind of board across the street. And you still see that today. It is fantastically amazing, but they kind of paid for it. So our job was doing something with a fraction of the budget. At Space, we call things destroying conventions to create demand. So we take a look at that convention and how to destroy that. So we have to outsmart and not outspend these guys. And that really was kind of the focus of the board itself, is doing something that is smarter, can actually retain people, but for, you know, a budget within half the price. So What do you do when you do that? You kind of make the world's largest computer. If you look in Times Square, you look around these things, there's these gigantic boards, but they're like television screens that are looking at you. But never did we flip that around and have it look back at you. So the board can see you, you can see the board like a gigantic computer screen. So if you look at your laptop or something and you see you have webcams on top of it. So we went out and found the most robust high-end webcam you possibly could find. So these things are in NASA. There's a robot they're making there in the corner that has these cameras for its eyeballs. It's going to be like an astronautless spaceman that's coming up like in the next couple of years. So very extreme environment cameras that we put on top of this board. And so if you look here, it's a shot of the board that we had a camera that was right here that could actually look down and see you. So if we put that camera on top of the board, we start getting footage like this. So the minute we start seeing this, we're like, okay, now we can actually do something. So the board is actually looking at people. What can we do with that? So again, add some geek. Let's go back to the original slides and put some of this stuff in here. So if you take a look at a lot of things out there, there's one thing we found was called computer vision. Computer vision basically can take an object like a calculator or a pencil or something and actually identify where that is. You can see there's doing pixel tracking here. Or even getting a product like a pencil and start identifying that within other things. So once you have a screen and you have a computer that can identify these different types of products, what do you do with it? So we added some freak, which is the best part, the 51%, and we started tracking people the exact same way. So this is actually our computer vision code that's tracking people on the street the same way it's tracking that calculator or that pencil in that sense. So now that you have a computer that can see people, it can determine what you can do with them. Now add in a little bit of the chic, the fast fashion. Let's add some kind of cool stuff to it with the Forever 21 style. Again, product is a big deal. So with that, I'll play the case study for our video product. So that's kind of this cool thing we did, yeah? So how do we do it? We've never before actually unveiled the technology behind this. There's a lot of case studies about the video you've seen, but I kind of want to get into the background a little bit and how we actually did that, especially as event marketers and people that try to do something new about optical illusions and tricks and things that are kind of Chris Angel stuff. It's really not that hard, but we can get this back to connecting. And I think that's another thing about connecting, again, with the brand and really going from a physical thing and connecting to the consumer like that. Having Forever 21's crowd right in front of the screen and having this kind of connection to the brand in a place like Times Square that's that crowded. So a little bit about behind the scenes. So we started out with traditional kind of television board mock-ups. The idea is of a Polaroid. Now that you have the computer vision, can you do a Polaroid? Can we physically pick the people up? She kisses a guy, he turns into a frog. She smells him. If she doesn't like him, she throws him over the shoulder or puts him in her bag and takes off. So there's a lot of fun stuff we could start doing here. This one was kind of the Polaroid shot, which was the most obvious and the easiest to do because it was a kind of a screen grab versus an individual, so we could get like a part of the crowd. When we started getting into the pickup stuff, this is some of our original test footage. So a lot of people thought the models were behind the board, and I think everybody still thinks that today. If they go to Times Square, there's a bunch of models, they can see you, you know, behind this kind of chicken coop thing, and they're picking you up around the street. And that's not the case. So just to let you know, don't break the secret, but they're not there. So so here's some of our test footage. You can see on the left, we have a test of a fake person, which was like this little doyle that we had, so like a little wooden peg on green screen, and when she reaches down to pick up the screen, we have to actually swap that doyle out with an image. So think Photoshop, you can circle an image on the crowd, you have to then optically swap that out very, very fast. If that doesn't happen, the trick doesn't work so well. So we really had this challenge of someone walking in and then reaching and having the model reach down and pick something up. And so we had to kind of play with these jump cuts, and I can show you a couple of those. There's a fake person, again, the yellow doyle, and from these different videos you'll see it, and then the real person there on the street that we outlined in computer vision, and we have to swap them out without you noticing. So I don't know how many people noticed the swap out in the screen, but I'll show you some problems with it originally. So we have her taking a picture, we can swap it out, jump cutting, this type of thing where she reaches down and you do a montage of images and then you swap out the person. That wasn't working so well. So we tried this kind of strobing effect. So if you imagine during the strobe, you swap the person out like that. But I think you saw the strobe, right? Yeah, so your retina kind of picked that up. So we had to get a little bit more creative on how to actually swap out that person. So here's the footage, and I'll play it a couple of times. You can see that when she reaches down, we do a cut. And right there at that cut is when we swapped it out. And then we pull that image back. So she walks in, and that really quick cut was taking that doyle and swapping it with the image of the person. Now, if you even look even closer, those people are still on the street. So she's picked up, you're looking at yourself there, but there's actually a replicated image of you still on the street. So you think you got picked up, you think you're getting passed around, but you're still there. So kind of fun stuff, you know. I got picked up by a model, but maybe I didn't. But nobody knew that. This is the first time we've actually exposed this kind of, you know, our little string behind the curtain, kind of rabbit under the hat kind of stuff, right? So this was really cool, though, for interactions, and the fact that we could get away with them this cheap and this fast, we weren't going to, like, blow our budget on just one big thing. Forever 21's about fast fashion. They're about really cheap clothing, really cheap things, kind of interaction. So we kind of went through and did a whole bunch of them. So seasonal things with girls playing tennis to you. You saw the holiday and the mistletoe. You know, we're doing stuff at the 4th of July. So overall, we had over 20 interactions on this stuff. And that was probably the coolest thing because the crowd was having such a great time getting passed to Big Ben or getting put into the Egyptian pyramids or the magnifying glass and all these different types of things. The frog kissing, all that kind of stuff was pretty cool. But again, it really played to the brand of what Forever 21 was. You know, if it was for Dolce & Gabbana, it might be this really kind of melodramatic black and white footage or something, you know, with high-end stuff. We kind of went a little bit more cheap. Here's a problem that happened, and that's actually my sun melting down. The cameras on the board melted down when Stuart Elliott came from the New York Times and wanted to do a preview of the board. The cameras melted. It was 95 degrees in New York City at the time, and so the technology dropped. So we all showed up, you know, big deal. Stuart Elliott, huge article, cameras melted. So it goes to show just even in a situation that you get NASA-like cameras, they still melt on Earth. Maybe not in space, but in New York they melt, which is kind of a problem. But, you know, it was a big, huge press opportunity that was one of the failures if you look at the project, and that was a big thing that we wanted to really debut as something new, a billboard that looks at you versus you looking at it, or vice versa, and then the cameras went down. So we could install the box and did some R&D behind it, and they don't melt anymore unless global warming changes that, which I don't know if that will in the next 5 years. We'll find out. Some of the results in this thing, 20 million in earned media in our world. Earned media is a big deal because that's not the paid media. We didn't pay 20 million to get the type of impressions here. So earned media is all the different kind of viral things, the blogging, the social, a lot of the different things that we're passing around. The value of that was about $20 million for Forever 21, which in Times Square was a huge deal. 5 million news and social posts, over 5 million on those, over 200 million views across Vimeo and YouTube. So this thing got passed around a lot. We knew that it was successful just by the fact that it was getting passed around. In Times Square, it's usually about a 3 second attention span. So if you're in Times Square, you see McDonald's or Coke or Pepsi or whatever, you got about 3 seconds a shot. We were averaging 3 to 6 minutes on our board. So this was a massive crowd, and I think we were just speaking to somebody about doing that Radisson tour and having a gigantic student crowd in front of the board. People thought it was like Tom Cruise was in the store or some celebrity or something. So even the fact that you turn it on, narcissism works, everybody stares at it like a bunch of lemmings, and they just stare at this board, and, you know, massive crowds of people, and then you can interact with them that way. So much so that people were going into the street right there on Broadway. And so the police made us turn the camera up just a little bit to move the crowd back. So it's almost like if I took the whole audience and shuffled you back by tilting a camera back and forth. So that worked pretty cool. And the best thing was American Eagle called us the next day and said, how can you work on our board? Which we thought was kind of a personal cool thing. Second round, one of the critiques we got was you got all these people, but they're not going in the store. So how do we make that happen? We screwed on a lens that was actually a little bit more closer up. So we went to a 5mm lens. And this kind of stuff allowed us to put people on the product itself. So if you take a look at the execution here, you put somebody on the shirt like this, and then you can go get those shirts inside the store. So that was the next revolution. There was a huge rainstorm that crushed some infrastructure in the store. We never got to do that, which was kind of a bummer. So if anyone wants to try that out, we have all the technology ready to go. Okay, we're going to wrap this up. Last thing I want to leave with is just some of the physical conventions destroyed here. Brands need to embrace the relevancy like Nike or Starbucks or Forever 21, not just for the cool factor of tech, but the fact that they can embrace that to stay relevant. Smart devices are getting smarter, as we know. Don't let technology interfere with the product in the sense that we made that Forever 21. It wasn't for any brand at all. And execution is the idea, and test the hell out of it. Don't get a meltdown on those cameras. So we test, test, and test. So there you go for Forever 20. Thank you so much on that.